The Supreme Court has dismissed an application by the All Progressive Congress APC, asking it to review its judgment, which nullified the victory of the candidates of its candidate, rather, at the 2019 general elections held in Zamfara State. The APC had also urged the Apex Court to order fresh elections. The court, led by the Chief Justice of Nigeria, Tanko Muhammad, held that the application by the APC is an abuse of court process. Still with me in the studio is Martin Tulumba, political analyst. Thank you for staying.
Pleasure.
And we still have on the phone legal practitioner Taiwo Akinlami. Thank you as well for staying with us.
Thank you very much.
Straight to you. Is it an abuse of court process? What's your thought?
Okay, that's to me, right?
Yes, to you.
Okay. Well, this is not the first time in this dispensation that the Supreme Court is going to have to review its judgment. It happened with the Imo State gubernatorial matter. It happened in the Bayelsa State gubernatorial matter. As a matter of fact, the Supreme Court, in one of those cases, you know, find the lawyer, you know, who brought the application for review. Now, the Supreme Court is the final court in the land. And the fundamental thing is that there has to be, the Supreme Court does not ordinarily, you know, overrule itself. Because once it gives a judgment, it only appeal to God. So, but you must have fundamental reason why you are approaching the court. So asking the Supreme Court to overrule itself is creating another Supreme Court inside the Supreme Court. So Supreme Court should become an appellate court to itself. There is magistrate court, which serves as the court of first instance in some matters. There is the High Court, which serves both as a court of first instance and an appellate court, because an appeal can move from magistrate court to the High Court. There's Court of Appeal, which serves as an appellate court, you know, to the High Court. Then Supreme Court is an appellate court to the Court of Appeal, except in constitutional cases, strong constitutional cases, where you can start from the Supreme Court. So the foundational thing is this. It is just toying with the authority of the Supreme Court, approaching the Supreme Court to overrule itself, as if the Supreme Court was asleep when it gave that judgment.
So if you hold this, if you hold this position, Taiwo, I'm sorry to interrupt. If you hold this position, then what is the precedence? The same judge that had a different opinion to give is also the same judge in this instance that also said that the Supreme Court can review its own judgment. How worrying is that? And if, I mean, he is a Supreme Court judge.
Yeah.
Shouldn't we take that seriously? What are the likely implications?
Well, this is the issue. The Supreme Court is one. Now, there are, if you are dealing with a constitutional matter, you have seven justices speaking. If you are dealing with a matter that is unconstitutional matter, you have five justices speaking. Now, the judgment of the Supreme Court is the judgment of the majority. So we have what we call dissenting judgment, which means a judge, a justice of the Supreme Court can disagree with his fellow brothers, and with his other brothers, as they are called, and disagree. So it's not a problem if a justice of Supreme Court disagrees with the judgment of the majority. At the end of the day, it is the judgment of the majority that becomes the judgment of the Supreme Court. And again, when Supreme Court gives a judgment, there's what we call obiter, and that's what we call the main subject matter of the case. I don't want to use legal jargon. Now, if you look at the subject matter of the case, and we are going to look at what is precedent, it is going to be the judgment of the majority. So the opinion of the minority will have its say. His or her say. Though everybody in Supreme Court is supposed to be a man, though there are women among them. But the judgment of the Supreme Court is the judgment of the majority.
Okay.
I'm not worried about the thinking of the minority. I'm worried, I should be worried about the thinking of the majority. And if it became a majority in this instance, is to say that this application is an abuse of court process and it should not be allowed.
Okay, I really wanted you to land so I don't interrupt you. I know you are not a legal practitioner,
yep.
But you must have a perspective on this matter. And in the local parlance, we say there is no smoke without fire. That one person is saying, I mean, it takes a brave soul to step aside from the norm and do something different. Shouldn't we be paying attention to this same person? This is not the first time he's taking this rodeo trip. He's done it before. What's your perspective on all of this?
Now, first off, we're all legal minds to the extent of natural justice. Everybody recognizes injustice when we see it. What is happening in Nigeria today or lately, I want to believe that in the course of time, all of this will be reviewed. Certainly, all of this will be reviewed because in the real sense, some of these things question the validity of our nationhood. Because you ask yourself, let me just revisit Imo, for instance. It's like saying that let us do all of the play at the level of maybe the tribunal, at the level of maybe the appeal court. Once you can have a good number of people on your side at the Supreme Court, it ends there. You know, if there is a fundamental blunder, I believe that natural justice requires that we review it. Fundamentally, as human beings, why we are different from the lesser creatures is because we can think rationally. We should be able to bring to bear logic. We should be able to bring all kinds of, you know, parameters that give us a sense of integrity. I'm not seeing it with the kinds of judgments that we're getting lately. Again, if we start from the Rotimi Amaechi case, it's baffling where you say, okay, fine, the mandate does not belong to the individual, it belongs to the party. Okay, we agree, mandate belongs to the party. Now what happens? Before the end of his second term, Amaechi leaves the party, goes to APC, and is able to serve out his term. It makes no sense. Now, that is on the one hand.
That was the second time. He got the Supreme Court judgment in the first term. He contested on that.
Taiwo, hold on.
Towards the end of second term.
Taiwo, just let him land and you will have the floor.
I just needed to correct that.
Okay.
It's important.
For me, I'm not convinced by what he has just said because my thoughts are very clear on this. You know, if I'm wearing this dress in your studio and for some reason you say to me that, you know, I'm supposed to wear something different from what I'm wearing, and for some reason I say, okay, give me a moment, let me go and change. And I go and change and I come and sit down. Suddenly you say to me what I was wearing before was actually the perfect dress to have worn. Ordinarily, it makes no sense to me. Now, bringing it to the current happenings in Zamfara. The argument is straightforward for me. The party primaries were not properly conducted, so they said. And because of that, a penalty, maybe a sanction against the party, asking for a review when that particular issue has not been addressed, for instance. There is nothing to suggest that the party had been rebranded or there is some kind of discipline or what have you. And in the same cycle, it's not as if we're talking about a different election. I feel that the Supreme Court was on track by saying that it's an abuse of court process.
Okay, Taiwo, I want to talk to you about the fine that was issued against the appellant, 2 million naira, I think. Not a lot of money, but do you think it might in some way serve as deterrent to others who might want to come and ask the Supreme Court to review its statement, its ruling? I bring that to you because you are of the opinion that the Supreme Court should not be reversing itself.
Well, I'm of the opinion that the Supreme Court should be allowed to play its role as a Supreme Court. And that if you are going to come before the Supreme Court, you must have better and further facts. You don't come to the Supreme Court and tell the Supreme Court the arguments you have made before to come and remind them as if they did not avert their mind to the argument you made before. It's a waste of time of the Supreme Court. Now, and of resources, the resources of the nation. So I think this is not the first time the Supreme Court is going to award costs. You know, it did it in the Bayelsa State case, and it's doing it again now. So it's not the first time. I think the people who are involved in this are senior members of the bar, senior advocates of Nigeria, who should have known better. And that is what the Supreme Court is saying, that who much is given, much is expected. Now, beyond all of that, it is important to know, to note, that all of these that we are discussing, the Supreme Court, the review of the judgment and all of that, we must look at it vis-a-vis how it translates to better government in terms of the fact that Chapter 2 of the Constitution says the welfare and the security of the people shall be the primary of government, whether it is PDP or APC. By the way, I don't believe that there's PCP or APC. I believe there's one ruling class that is riding roughshod on the questioning and aspiration of the people. So whether it is PDP or APC, I'm not a fan of any of them. I still want political class. So at the end of the day, our interest should transcend beyond the cost that the Supreme Court has awarded and all of that. Our interest should be whether it is APC, whether it is PDP, whether it is ACN, whatever it is called, which of them represent the interest of the people. So the agitation of Nigeria should be towards good governance, good governance. And good governance is not going to be delivered on the last of the people. The people must agitate for it peacefully. So those are fundamental issues that I think we should take away from all of this. All of these are distractions from the main issue.
All right. Now, I'm still talking about the legal profession. Let's move a bit and talk about developments as regards both the COVID-19 situation. I'm bringing this up because there seem to be a lot of agitation when it comes to the news that our legislators have taken delivery of exotic cars. Many Nigerians have expressed a whole lot of displeasure. And I think the way I put it here is there maybe an explanation that would discredit the displeasure that has trailed the receipt of these exotic cars? Now, before you answer that, Martins, I want to take your mind back a bit that we already knew of COVID-19 as a December. As a January, it was already spreading to other countries of the world. The discussion about the delivery of these cars was done in February, I think the first week of February, the 5th or thereabout. And now, in the midst of this pandemic, these cars, in spite of all the precautionary measures that have been put in place. So I just want you, for the benefit of doubt, is there any argument that would discredit the displeasure being showed across board?
I don't think that there's any argument that can be put forward to defend what appears to be like the National Assembly is probably insensitive to the realities that are on ground in Nigeria today. Now, to that extent, it will appear that the way we prioritize things in Nigeria, there are two classes of people, not necessarily the elites, but those who are in some political grouping, because in the National Assembly, you have different parties there. And I've not heard of any dissenting voice saying that, no, this is not the right way to go. And they've gone ahead. I understand that the cars are being distributed at about now, you know, in the midst of this pandemic. And again, with all of the preachments about buy made in Nigeria and what have you, I want to believe that the purpose of these utility vehicles is to be able to take them from point A to point B. And so that they can work. Their work, it doesn't really have to translate to flamboyance. I'm just saying that it doesn't have to translate to flamboyance and what have you. Because they are big men, if they are in a position to afford for themselves any kind of vehicles that they want, I wonder why they have to push that burden on Nigerians. That's the way I see it.
Okay, I'm going to move away from that, except, Taiwo, you have a quick thought on it. I will move on to another issue that is...
Okay, I just have a quick thought on that.
Okay.
I think that what we are seeing is that those who have been saddled with the responsibility of providing leadership in terms of taking responsibility for the welfare and the security of the people, which is the primary aim of government, are taking the people for granted. And my concern is not about the fact that the cars have been distributed. Maybe one way or the other, the cars will be distributed. My problem is with how we arrived at getting this car. Innocent is making cars in Nigeria, and he bidded for this car, to supply this car. The lawmakers voted against that and voted for a car that is not made in Nigeria. And government is supposed to model behavior. They are supposed to lead by example. And they are the one telling us, made in Nigeria, make in Nigeria, and all of this. And at the end of the day, when it comes for them, when it comes to when they had the opportunity of showing leadership, of showing strength, they deviated. And they showed us that they don't really believe about this whole idea of making Nigeria. Do you know what picking up those cars will have done to the economy of Nigeria and innocent? Do you know what will have happened to people generally if our lawmakers can use this car, that they will use the same car? So those are fundamental issues for me.
All right, Taiwo, thank you very much for that. I wouldn't want us to go talking about the fact that we don't know the cost. Nobody seems to know the cost of these cars. We'll leave that conversation for another day.
Because
we'll leave that for another day so we can put in as much as we have. This is the about the last plus politics we have for this week. So I will go ahead and ask you about the seeming little bit of misunderstanding that appeared yesterday when the NCDC announced the new cases that was found in a vessel, on a vessel rather, and the NPA, that's the Nigerian Ports Authority, responded and was saying they are not aware of these cases and they weren't communicated. My question basically is, does it indicate a communication gap and how quickly should this be addressed, especially now when we need everybody to be on the same boat as we fight this pandemic, Martins?
The way we've been running government lately, there is obvious communication gap. And a good example will be that the office of the vice president appears to just be an observer, like the rest of us. Having said that, between the NPA and the NCDC, this misunderstanding could easily have been avoided if the NCDC people took the NPA, you know, as partners in progress. Any governmental agency, I want to believe, there should be some intergovernmental synergy in what they do. And the way the news broke, it will appear that the NCDC did some abracadabra to be able to maybe go on board the vessel. And
but considering the exigency is of the time, is it enough to be going
they
to
should
consult
patch it up
people?
Quickly.
Yes,
they should patch it up
yes.
quickly.
Okay, Taiwo, your quick thoughts, your last thought in 30 seconds about the importance of communication, because that little spat,
this is not the first time we are going to see this kind of thing. So when two government agencies are fighting each other on information, there's crisis. And so that is going to impede on the confidence of the people on how to receive information from government. Remember the other time, government came and said pump price of fuel was 125. Without having conversation with the marketer, then they ran into a crisis. I think they need to fine-tune their processes and their efforts so that they can speak with one voice to the people. so that people can have confidence, whatever information that emanates from them.
All right. Thank you very much, Taiwo, for joining us on the program.
Thank you for having me.
And of course, Martins, thank you for coming all the way in spite of all the social distancing.
Thank you, too.
Staying at home. All right. And thank you for watching thus far. But we're not done yet. We'll just go on a quick break. And when we return, I will give my take. Do stay with us. Something is better than nothing. President Muhammadu Buhari has informed us of the efforts his government is making to help fight the ravaging coronavirus pandemic. And as a people, I trust we will continue to watch, critic positively, and do what we can to help. One pressing thought tonight, though, is please do not binge watch the news. By all means, stay informed via the right sources. But do other things to keep your mind positive in this very trying time. This too shall pass. Thank you for watching, and I will see you Monday.